We are in the midst of series, not the midst of series, actually in the end of the series. And it was titled as Underdogs. I think whoever has been attending last 4 weeks would connect with me, what Pastor has been speaking to you all about this series called Underdogs. The whole purpose of the series is, you know, everyone has their own excuse to tell God, and God in His mercy and His faithfulness, He gives us the courage and the confidence to live out a Christian life or a faithful, obedient life to Him in this world, and we need to trust Him. So there are two things by the end of this series, if we can get, it will be fantastic. One is to give each one of you the confidence. Though we have that thought of that underdog in our lives, that we are not up to that mark, and we always find some excuse. If you see the first week, I think we saw nobody recognizes my potential. And I think Pastor took through Joseph's lives and how God brought about a beautiful transformation, made him a prime minister of a nation. And then we saw Jacob, who said, my reputation is too scarred. I'm just not reputed enough to live for Jesus. And there too, how God had brought about Jacob and his purpose in his life. The third one we saw about Mishaboth, who was a crippled person in David's house, how through his life that I am not connected to the right people, and how God brought about the connection and how he was able to get favor in the eyes of David. And finally, on the Easter morning, my opponent is too great is what through Jesus' life we saw, and how he risen and did his Father's will in all those oppositions which the devil had brought. So I think we have been seeing how people have been giving their excuses and how God gives them the assurance that he is with him, and believing in that and trusting him, how they stood out as a different person, though they are an underdog. So this is the whole big idea. Even when it looks that our chances are too slim, we serve a God who makes a way for us. So today's topic is, my chances are too slim. We're going to see from the life of Esther, the book of Esther, and then we would conclude this series. So with this, can we close our eyes and look to the Lord in prayer? Gracious Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for teaching us last 4 weeks that we are meek people. We are weak. We do not know how to take decisions. When we are in the crossroads. Lord, you have been our confidence. You have been teaching us to be confident. Help us to trust you completely, so that we can live out our lives glorifying you and testifying you in our lives, Lord. Thank you that you are going to accomplish what you have to do in the hearts of people through this series, Underdog. Cover me, speak through me, Lord, to the people, and let us hear from you and be obedient to whatever you say and practice it in our lives, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How many of you know the life of Esther in the book called Esther? Have you read it completely? Have you know what is the storyline of that book? I'm sure many of you would have done. Just for people who have really not gone through the full book, I thought I'll give you a small introduction of what this book is all about. Esther is, if you can find, it's before Job, and it is after Nehemiah. So it's in between. It has around 7 chapters. No, sorry, 10 chapters. And it was actually in the captive, when Jewish people were in the captive and the Israelites were under a king called, you know, Zeresh. It is in the first chapter that it says that they were all in captive, and King Zeresh had a beautiful wife who was actually, you know, very, very beautiful. And when actually he threw a beautiful banquet for all his ministers in the kingdom, and as he was throwing his banquet, he also suddenly had an idea. I think he must have got drunk, that's what the Bible says. And then he called his beautiful queen, Vashti, to come and parade, to show her beauty to the people. And the queen, you know, refused to come to the banquet because the intention was not right. So immediately the king got very angry and he said, how can she disobey my orders? And then he consulted some of his ministers, and the ministers said, if this is the case, you know, none of the wives in the kingdom will obey their husbands, and you need to teach her a lesson, take her from the, you know, position of the queen. And immediately the king ordered that she will be away from the position of the queen. And then the other ministers said, let's now look for a new queen. And then the king ordered, so let's call all the virgins in the kingdom and tell them to apply for this post. So as many people were coming forward, there was one girl called Esther, who was actually a Jew. She is an orphan. She was brought up by a person called Mordecai, who was supposed to be his her relative. And she was growing up in Mordecai's house. And as Mordecai told her, you must apply for this, and she applied. And as she went to the palace, they gave her beauty treatment for a long time, because for all the virgins who applied, they had given. And there will be an appointed day where the king will select the queen. And as she went on the appointed day, Esther was selected. And as she was selected, then again, she was being given the position of the queen. And Mordecai said, never reveal that you are a Jew to the king. So she kept quiet. In the meanwhile, when Mordecai, as she became the queen, was sitting down in the palace front gates, he heard two soldiers. It's a lovely story, so I'm sure you're all enjoying the story. He was sitting down in the front of the palace, and he heard two soldiers conspiring against the king. So when he heard that, he said, I must tell the king about this. So he went and told Queen Esther to tell the king there are two soldiers who are trying to conspire against the king to kill him. So Esther went and told the king, and then he found out that it was true, and those two soldiers were killed or murdered. And once they were eliminated, he also asked who's responsible for this. And when they said Mordecai, he recorded in his record saying that the person called Mordecai saved my life by giving me an information. So once that was happened, there was one more villain in the story who's called Haman. This Haman actually is a minister in the kingdom, and he actually wanted to, you know, become the greatest. So he actually was trying to see that everybody bows to him. And Mordecai actually did not really, you know, he glorifies God, he's a Jew, and he believes in Jehovah. So he said, why should I bow to this man? And Haman got very angry, and he said, let me eliminate this guy who doesn't bow to me. And then he made a huge, gallows to hang Mordecai. That was his plan. And then he came and told the king that Jews who are actually in this land do not obey you. They obey to a God who is supposed to be above than you. So the king got a little angry, and he somehow got a king to issue an order that if they don't, you know, worship what the king wants, then they will be killed in the kingdom. So that kind of an order was issued in the kingdom. And Mordecai knew that it is against the Jews. So he sends a word to Esther to go and tell the king that this is what has happened and to cancel that order. Now, those days, you can't just like that appear in front of the king. It needs an appointment. So what she did was she kind of took a bold step. But before that, she said that Mordecai, start praying for 3 days. Let's fast and pray. Then I will go and stand in front of the king. So when that happened, then she said, let me have a banquet again for the king. And she called all the ministers, and Haman also was there in the banquet. And after 2 days, she opened up and told him. And when the king was very satisfied with the queen, she said, tell me what you want, I'll give you half of the kingdom. That's the time she took and she said, there is an order which has come against us, if you can get it canceled. So immediately king sends off the order to cancel it. And then he asked him, who made this? And then she said, Haman. And immediately he was very angry with Haman, and he wanted to kill him, eliminate him also. Then, Haman, out of his fear, he started holding Esther's legs and said, can you please plead for me? And the king saw that in my presence you are holding the king's, the queen's leg. And he got very angry, and then he ordered that the same gallows which was made for Mordecai was, Haman was taken and he was hanged there. And that was the whole story of Esther. And then Esther and Mordecai were given the position of Haman as the minister, and she was the queen. So this is the whole story of Esther. So she took a risk when she had to take a risk for God. So there are 4 things which we learn from Esther's life. The first thing is, Esther had intangibles. She had intangibles which she could not see, but God saw. But she believed that there is somebody who has given her a beautiful purpose in her life. If you see chapter 2, verse 15 of Esther, it says, when the turn came for Esther to go to the king and ask for nothing other than Haggai, the king's eunuch, who was in charge of the harem, suggested, and Esther won the favor of everyone who saw her. From God, though she took one step to go and present herself to be the next queen, though she was a Jew, you can't have a chance in front of Persians to be there as another, country person to be there as a queen. But she still stood there, applied for that post and went. And God showed favor in the eyes of people. There's one thing that qualified Esther was not what she had in natural, but what she had in supernatural. To make a difference and to stand out, to be unique, it requires confidence in God who created us. And we need to believe that there is a unique purpose for each one of us, which Esther believed, and which is not seen. It is only between you and God that God reveals his purpose to you. And I'm sure Esther realized it. There is a purpose for me to be in this captive land as a Jew, and I need to apply for this post. And she did that in boldness. Each one of us, Psalm 113, 14, verse 14 says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we each one of us have a purpose to be accomplished in this world. There is a story, not this is a real instance, which happened in Afghanistan. It is in the internet. You can go and check it. It's a beautiful story about, two sisters who were born with their heads attached. Anybody remember that story? It's sometime in early 2000. It came out in the papers also. Their name was Laden and Leigh Bijani. And they were in city of Southwest in Afghanistan. And the beauty in their creation is their brains are different, but their head is together. Body is separate. Only their head, one place, is got, attached with each other. And their thinking was different, their conscience was different, their brain was different, everything was different. And they had different choices to make in their lives too. Laden wanted to be a lawyer, whereas while Leigh wished to become a journalist. And in the end, they had to settle down with one person's choice because they can't be in two different places. So they settled down with Laden's choice to become a lawyer, and they studied law in Tehran University. The one person was very discontented because naturally she wanted to become a journalist. And then Leigh hoped that she could move to Tehran, to the capital city of Iran, to study journalism, while Laden wanted to continue her graduate studies in that place. So again, she had to give it for her sister to continue. Slowly the frustration started with one of them. In fact, Laden was preferred a computer programmer, and Leigh was described to be more, introvert to herself. But the other one is very talkative. So they had their clear differences, but they could not do it. Finally, they decided to, get operated. So a Japanese doctor, very famous doctor, tried to do the operation, but it failed. When it failed and they died, that came in papers saying that, the two sisters had passed away. What shows from this whole story is, each one of us are unique, and God has given us a beautiful purpose to stand for Him, and we need to realize that purpose. And unless we connect with God, we will not be able to realize what that purpose is. And sometimes we are so carried away by this world when we see many, some of the heroes I've been seeing from those days, the pant becomes a small pant, then bottom, then it becomes bell bottom, then it becomes again smaller. We all so much used to get, copying from people. We want this this style, that style, everything we want to copy from either a Cinefield or somebody who is a hero for each one of us. But we can't really live their lives. What I'm trying to say is we have our uniqueness. And just one thing which I think it's also in the notes, it says God made each one of us as a first-class origin. There is no duplicate. Our purpose is very unique for each one of us. And let us not die as a second-grade copy who you want to be. Let's not try and copy and try and be. Let's be unique. As Hester took that decision, believing her in her supernatural purpose, and took that decision, though she was naturally beautiful, but she did not put that faith in that natural beauty, but she believed that there was a supernatural power, and she took that risk. The second thing which we see from Esther's life, she was confident because she was chosen. She was chosen by the king. Chapter 2, verse 17 says like this, "Now the king was attracted to Esther more than any other woman, and she won his favor and approval more than any other virgins. So he set a royal crown on her head and made her the queen instead of Vashti. Being chosen is again God's intervention. He chose us. In fact, if you look at how the king chose Esther, God has chosen each one of us. Though we find excuses, though we find, you know, something to say that I am not that person, but God says you are chosen. John chapter 1 verse 12 says, "Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave them the right to become the children of God." I think we went through Good Friday and Easter services. I'm sure we are sure of what we believe in. In case if we are not sure, I think we need to realize that we are born sinners in this world, and we continue to be in sin, which separates us from God. And the day we realize that we are sinners, we go to this God who has loved us eternally and loved us unconditionally and willing to forgive us, because he paid the price for each one of us on the cross. And as we believe that he paid the price for each one of us, when we confess our sins and accept him as our personal savior, he is willing to come inside our hearts. And not only that, he also gives us the position as a child of God. What an amazing God we have. He first loved us, he gave his life for us, and then he says, if you believe in this and accept your repentance, forgiveness, I'll make you my child. So that's the amazing God we have. So as Queen Esther was chosen, God chose each one of us. In fact, in 1 Peter 2:9, we see that we have been chosen as chosen people, royal priesthood, and holy nation, God's special position in God's kingdom. That's the kind of, titles which God gives us. You know, we are a royal priesthood and a holy nation, God's special position in God's kingdom. All we need to do is believe and have that confidence and behave that we are a king's son. Because in God's kingdom, if we are part of, and we are son of, a person who has died for it, and he is the king of the world, and we are also becoming a heirs to his kingdom. You know, we need to have that confidence and to behave like that. I remember still one of the evangelists used to write his emails and finally sign off saying it, son of a king. You know, instead of saying yours faithfully, he says son of a king, and then he will sign. I know of a preacher, I think he's been in our church also, Rajkumar Ramchandran. He's been throughout the world, and his passport is such a big passport. And when the immigration officer asked him, you know, what are you doing? He says, I do my father's business. So who's your father? So he's the creator of the world. So immigration officer looked at him and, you know, said, I don't understand this. That too in Russia. And he said, no, he is willing to be your father also if you are willing to believe him. And he shared the gospel. So what I'm trying to say is, God is, you know, chosen each one of us as his child, and we have been given a special status in his kingdom, and we need to believe that. And he has also given us the Holy Spirit, which confirms this to each one of us. Romans chapter 8 verse 14 to 17 says, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. The Spirit who received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit who received brought about your adoption to sonship. In fact, every time we kind of doubt that are we a child of God, the Spirit who is inside us tells us that we are an adopted child and we are part of God's family. What an amazing God we have. He also gives us and He resides in us as Holy Spirit and keeps reminding us that we are chosen and we are part of the family. Being chosen and being a child of God has three clear benefits. One is we have amazing security in God. You know, we don't have to fear about anything. God is our security. I think there were a lot of prayer requests for jobs which are being suddenly lost, and we need to pray as a church. God is our security. If we have that strong faith and confidence, I'm sure we will be able to take the risk. Even though we try and tell our excuses as underdogs, I think God has clearly given us that security, that which we can believe that He gave us the job and He will be able to give one more job, or He will be able to work out His purpose in our lives. So security is something which we get as children of God in His kingdom. And we don't have to fear. And all we need to do is to have confidence in God who gave us that security. The second one is He gives us authority. A slave or a servant at the home does not have the same authority as the master. Correct? But God gives us authority because we are part of His family. You know, a son and a father has different authority than a slave or a servant at home. So we have the authority which the parents have at home, and we have given us, He has given us the authority because He has won the devil on the cross and He has overcome the sin. Same authority He has given us to have authority over sin and to have a victorious life. Sometimes we forget this. As a chosen person in God's kingdom, as His son and daughters, we forget that we have this authority over sin. And we so much get succumbed to the pressure of sin. I think we need to tell the devil that he is a defeated fellow on the cross and use that authority which God has given each one of us. And the third one the child of God has is identity. The moment we start getting a job and the first visiting card we get in our lives, we slowly start forgetting that it is God who gave us. You know, when we say, "Who are you?" instead of saying, "I'm a child of a living God," like how Rajkumar told the immigration officer, we always say, "I am so-and-so in so-and-so company." What becomes our identity? Literally our jobs, correct? Imagine if a child gets lost in an exhibition or in a circus or, you know, in a public place, and the policeman finds the child and, you know, asks the child, "Who are you?" He doesn't say, you know, "I am so-and-so, so-and-so." What that child says is, "I am son of so-and-so." Immediately they will go to the mic and announce, "Your child is here alone. Please come and pick up your child." That's why in Matthew chapter 18, Jesus beautifully says, unless you become like a child, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. Our identity is in Him who has died in each one of our place and given us that position to be sons and daughters of a living God. Sometimes we start trusting in our own positions that we forget that what God has given to us. So security lies in Him. Our identity lies in him, and our authority also has been given as a child of God. We are seeing that Esther, being chosen by the king, never forgot that she was a Jew. And she stood for her people, even though that position was given. The third one which we saw, we see in Esther's life, is Esther had God working behind the scenes on her behalf. This happens in each one of our lives. In fact, King turns in his favor towards Mordecai and Esther, and evil Haman is hanged in his own gallows. But was it all Esther's cleverness that she brought about all these things? No. It was not that. It was God who was lining up these events long before Esther spoke a single word. Before she even took that decision, God was lining up all these events. In fact, Esther wasn't acting alone to save her people. God was working on her behalf behind the scenes. If you see Joseph's life, the first topic which Pastor was speaking on, underdogs, we saw that, you know, did he know that he's going to become the prime minister of Egypt? He did not know, correct? But God was beautifully working behind the scenes. Even though he had his own fall, brothers were against him, he was sold as a slave, he was in prison. In all those circumstances, God was working behind the scene. Correctly at the time when God had to intervene, he will intervene. He will put the thought in the prison's, head of the prison, at the home where he was working. He was, given the right thought that he could interpret the dream, and then the guards took him to the Pharaoh. All those things, God beautifully worked behind the scenes. In fact, Saul, who was converted as Paul, was a ruthless man. He was killing Christians left and right, and he was kind of, head of persecution. He was doing against against God's people who believed in Christ. And see how God touched him and changed him. All his, knowledge and wisdom about the Jewish culture and whatever he had learned was put in use when God started using him. So God knew that he is going to be my faithful servant, and he prepared him in such a way. So we need to understand that it's same true in our lives, that God seems to be absent, but he is actually working behind the scenes, moving in his ways which we cannot see. We need to trust God and hold on. He holds our future, and he's working out it for good for those who love him. We are not alone. We have a creator of the world who's with us, and God is the director behind the scenes. God has a way of arranging the circumstances to create what we call as God coincidence. It's not just the coincidence, but he arranges each one of our lives to work out our purpose. When we realize that we have a unique purpose and we decide to act like a child of God, as a chosen person, he works out behind the scenes. There is a beautiful song which we always sing, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know that he holds my future, life is worth the living just because he lives. He holds our future. We don't have to worry because he works behind the scenes. If you look at a programming, when we actually get the result in front, We don't know how many programs are running at the back, isn't it? I'm sure many are programmers. We say behind the scenes, a lot of programs are running. Sometimes it can crash us also, but God does not allow us to crash. He works in beautiful ways that He brings about our purposes as we live for Him and stand for Him. The final thing which we see Esther taking courage to make the right decision, even when it is a hard decision, is in chapter 4, verse 15. Esther chapter 4, verse 15. It says, "Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, 'Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night and day, and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go and to the king, even though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish.'" She took a courageous stand for God. That is something which is very hard to do. And God calls us to do that. When we realize our unique purpose, and when we are knowing that we are chosen for Him, and when we know that God is working behind our scenes, this decision is not difficult. But we need to believe these things. As she took that decision to stand for Him and to save her people from that order which King had given, she was bold to go and stand in front of God. As the Bible says, "If I perish, I perish. Even if my job goes, I will not do these things which is against God." I have many examples for it. There was a known friend called Reuben, who was in Bombay, who was working for a big company. We didn't want to name the company. Suddenly had a circular from their head office saying that, you know, you need to do a puja on Monday morning and start the office. And as a head of that Bombay branch, you need to break a coconut. And he said, "Sorry, I have my own, I have my own personal beliefs, which I cannot do it." And he put his foot down. So they said, immediately complaint went to head office that he is not being part of the team. He has been standing out. And if he is trying to take such a stand, he can never be a head of that branch. So they said, "It's better you resign." So he had to give his resignation. And as he gave his resignation, he had 3 children living in Bombay, imagine. And as he was going to the interviews after this instance, what do you think the interviewer first will ask? What was the reason you left your previous job, correct? What he has to say? He has to say the truth, because he is loving God and he is a child of God. So he had to say that I stood for my faith and they did not like it. So they thought, "Oh, this fellow is a fanatic. Let me not give him appointment in my office." Almost 4 months without salary in Bombay, he was going knocking door after door. And finally, it was a Korean company, shipping company. He had to go for an interview. And when he had to say that, you know, he stood for his faith, the interviewer suddenly asked him, "Are you a believer?" This fellow was shocked. He said, "Yes, I am, follow Jesus Christ and I am a believer." So he said, "Yeah, I am from South Korea. I am also a believer. I am very happy that you took your stand. And I am very happy about your credentials." And he gave him a post of general manager in that shipping company with double the salary for, and, you know, with full, you know, freedom to what he wants to do for Christ. See how God honors people. All you need to do is to take a stand for him. When we do that, he will do the rest for us. He will give, how we saw Job, you know, much more than what he had, God had given him back. Look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. One more example from Bible. Even there, you know, Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 and 17 says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it, and he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know that your majesty, that we will not serve your gods and worship the image of gold you have set up. See the stand they take for God. And you know the rest of the story. God was waiting for them inside the furnace as a fourth person, receiving these three people inside the furnace. God is an amazing God. It's our part to choose and to be courageous. It comes from dependence from God. If you see both the places where Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego and in King Esther's place, both of the places you will see, if you see in Daniel chapter 2, you know, it says Daniel told his friends to pray, you know, before he went and revealed that dream to the king, because it was a very difficult dream. He says, you tell the dream and interpret it. So Daniel was totally, you know, stuck, and he was so dependent on God that he told his friends to pray. And their friends were prayerful people, and they prayed, and God revealed the dream to Daniel. They knew their God so much that they can depend on him and be courageous. Even in Esther, what she says immediately, go back and tell the people to fast and pray. Because she knew God is a prayer answering God. She knew the God whom she was worshiping was faithful. And she was able to depend on this God. If we have to take such courageous step in our lives, do we have that relationship with our God who saved us? It's a daily relationship which we need to build on. He's given us a beautiful love letter which we need to read, and we need to pray. We find it so difficult to set aside some time to pray in the morning. And we see in Nehemiah chapter 1, when he spoke to the king, you know, it says he prayed and then spoke to the king. We call it as telegraphic prayer. That's the kind of relationship Nehemiah had with his God. He just said, Lord, give me wisdom to what I need to speak. And then he started speaking to the king, and he asked permission to go and build the wall. Do you have that confidence? Unless we start trusting him and relying on him in every walk of our lives, we will not get that confidence to stand for him. So we need to really put faith and confidence and build that relationship on a daily basis, so that we will be able to make the right choice even at the time of difficulty. Esther saved and changed the world, saved her people and changed the world. Do you want to take such decisions which can change the world in your place or in your purpose which God has brought you into this world? All we need to do is boldly take that step and stand for him. I will give you one more illustration and I will close, which is a very powerful illustration which I learned from my life, which is a true instance. You can check it up in the web also. His name was Jagadish Pandian. He was an IAS cadre from 1990s, I think early 90s, 91, 92. And he served in Gujarat when Prime Minister Modi was the chief minister in Gujarat. And there was one project which had to be approved because he was a special duty officer who was assigned specifically for the development of Gujarat. And there was a huge project which had to be done. And that's the time when election was around and you know, people were looking out for some scam so that they can come up. And also, they also needed money for elections. So they said, we are approving a particular contractor whom you have to sign and give. So he kind of put his foot down and said, sorry, I cannot do this. L&T, of course, was the best in laying the pipes. And it was a huge 3,000 crore project. And he said, I cannot do it. And they don't stand the technical or the financial strength. And so he said, I will not do it. The moment, you know, Chief Minister heard about it, he came to his office, picked him up, and on his way told him that you need to do this because it is good for the state. You have to give it to this contractor. And he politely declined, saying that you have not brought me to this post. It is my God who brought me, and I am not going to do this against, you know, work ethics. Modi was very upset. He dropped him on the way, half the way down, and said, you can walk and go. We'll see what to do with you. And things proceeded. He signed off. He gave it to the actual contractor, L&T, and the whole thing went off. After 6 months, when the election is over, he suddenly saw Modi coming back to his office and praising him, saying that it was a good decision you took. I heard from an inside information that the opposition were trying to find out some scam because this order was released, but they could not find anything because I had an honest officer like you. And he appreciated him, and then he gave him a very special position because he knew his was an his integrity was very high, and he gave him a very, very high position, and he is now a special emissary in Delhi. He is retired, but he has been appointed by the government of India to other countries, and he is traveling. He is very close to our circle, which is called EGF. He's been part of it, and he personally told this story. That's why I'm boldly telling you this. God is an amazing God when we stand for Him. He is not worried about His job. He is not worried about His reputation. He stood for God. And do you know what happened? In 2002, there was a very, very big persecution among Christians in Gujarat. I know how many of you remember. And Dang's community was under threat because of, you know, Gujarat, you know, persecution. And because he was in power, very close to the chief minister, he could issue orders to the police commissioners and the DGP saying that protect them. God kept Jagadish Pandian at the right place to protect Christians in Gujarat at the time of persecution. And it was reduced much because he was able to represent for the Christian community. And persecution was reduced. See how God beautifully plans. All we need to do is stand for Him. As underdogs, how many more days are we going to give our excuses that we cannot fight sin, we cannot do something for God and take a stand for God? God is reminding us through this series that we need to take heart and to stand for Him at any circumstances. The story is not yet over. It is beginning with your lives. God is going to do many big things as each one of us realizing our purpose and realizing that we are chosen children of God and we have the confidence that God is working behind our sins, behind the scenes, and to stand for Him. If you're lacking confidence, take courage. Look at Esther's life, look at Joseph's life. Many people who believed in God and took their chances and took their choices and stood for God, and God was with them and He was able to work out His purpose through each one of their lives. Shall we close our eyes and look to the Lord in prayer? Maybe a minute if we can be silent in God's presence and to even think what He has been speaking to us last 5 weeks through different characters of the Bible. None of them were great people. They all had their excuses. But they knew their own God so well that they could take their choices at the right time and stand for Him. God is a great God, not only has chosen us and not only given us a beautiful purpose in our lives that we need to do great things for Him, accomplish great things for Him. He's waiting for us to take that decision to stand for Him. He'll turn around one small instance into an amazing situation where His name can be glorified. He's waiting for us to take that decision. So let us confess that there is no more excuses, that we cannot win sin in our lives, that we cannot testify about Jesus in our lives. Boldly stand for Him in our offices, because our purpose is to glorify Him. Gracious Father, we want to thank You, Lord, for teaching us from Your word last 5 weeks from different people in the Bible, that how they started trusting You, not in our own identity. Our security is in You, Lord, as children of God. Help us to completely rely on You. Have that confidence and to take that stand when the time comes, so that Your name would be glorified, and through our lives, many, many would come to know You, Lord. We submit each one of us to that cause as we stand in this world. Thank You for Your unique purposes in each one of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, I want to be holy, holy in all that I do. Lord, I want to be holy, give the glory to You. Lord, I want to be faithful in all that I do. Lord, I want to be faithful and to give the glory to You. Sing together. Lord, I want to be faithful in all that I do. Lord, I want to be faithful and to give the glory to You. Lord, I want to be holy in all that I do. Lord, I want to be holy and to give the glory to You.
Oh, thank You, Jesus. Let's rise to our feet even as we close the service. We'll finish the series of the God of the Underdogs, and I'm sure we've all learned many lessons. I'm going to keep you standing for just about 50 seconds, because we're just going to play a a small glimpse of what the next series is going to be. So just stand by and just take a look as I run the video. That's going to be our next series from May 5th. So pray about it. Come prepared for what God has in store for each one of us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful morning. Thank you, Lord, for helping us to come and worship you and praise you with whoever we are and whatever we are, Father God. We have enjoyed you this morning. We thank you, Lord, that your word has come forth, Lord Jesus, that has ministered to each one of us. Because you know our hearts very well. We thank you for